بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن ولا وبعد. One or two issues, Ikhwan. Please remember we are in a residential area here. So as you leave, Ikhwan, please try and leave as quietly as possible. It is quite late. And apparently we've had one or two complaints, Ikhwan, over the last few nights. So please, as you leave, try and leave يعني with as little noise as possible. جزاكم الله خير. A second issue, Ikhwan, concerning the qunut in tonight's qira'ah and in tonight's qiyam. What we participated in just now, Ikhwan, in the dua of qunut before the ruku', as some of you were caught out by that. That is established, Ikhwan, in the sunnah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made the dua of qunut before the ruku', and it has almost become an abandoned sunnah in our era. But of course, Ikhwan, being the people of sunnah, Ikhwan, we try and revitalize these sunan that have been abandoned, and the people practice little. For indeed, the path and the method of Ahlul Sunnah, Ikhwan, is to teach the people the sunnah and to revitalize the sunan that have been lost. But it is established that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made the dua of qunut before he went into ruku'. And so what is important is when we follow the imam, that we follow the imam, Ikhwan, and that we don't jump the gun. And yeah, make our ruku' or move before we are certain of what it is the imam has done. As the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned, إِنَّمَا جُئِلَ الْإِمَامُ لِيُؤْتَمَّ بِهِ. That indeed the imam was established and has been placed for you to follow. And so you don't predict what he's going to do, you follow him. And so pay attention to that, Ikhwan, in the future. And wherever you pray, yani it may be something that some other masjid that you pray in, that you may experience that. Our other masjid in Wright Street, you may pray, Ikhwan, behind the imam and experience that. So be careful when you are praying behind the imam. Make sure that you're following him. For indeed, the people of knowledge have mentioned that that is from the things that may possibly nullify a person's salah, that he precedes the imam. Similarly, Ikhwan, from the issues in tonight's session, the dua that our brother made, Jazahullahu Khaira, from the established ad'iyah of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allahumma inni as'aluka al-huda wa-tuqa wal-afafa wal-ghina. As far as the dua and this dua of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is concerned, then without doubt, Ikhwan, it contains within it khair, and it is from the comprehensive and the jawami' al-kalim of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Oh Allah, indeed I ask you for huda. Ahlul ilm mention that the affair of huda or guidance is categorized into two categories: the hidayah that is known as hidayatul irshad and the hidayatul tawfiq. Hidayatul irshad is that which occurs at the hands of the people of knowledge, at the hands of the scholars, at the hands of the callers to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is their instructing individuals with khair, that they guide them towards the good, they instruct them with it, they teach them that which has come from Allah Azza wa Jalla and His Messenger. And so that is known as hidayatul irshad. And so this instruction, ayyuhal ikhwa, that comes to an individual, it is the beginnings of his hidayah, ya'ni that someone approaches him and someone teaches him, that someone informs him. And the people of sunnah, ikhwan, we need to be aware of the fact that the affair of hidayatul irshad is in the hands of the people of sunnah. For indeed, it is the people of sunnah that is going to instruct those who have strayed away from the path of Allah Azza wa Jalla and His Messenger and His Sahaba. It is Ahlul Sunnah, the people and the followers of the Salaf of this Ummah, the Salafiyun. It is they, Ikhwan, who are going to instruct the Ummah of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with that which the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam left and that which was understood by the Sahaba Ridwanullahi Alayhim. And so since that is the case, it is an issue that each and every one of us needs to recognize and understand that it is our responsibility. When we come across individuals, Ikhwan, that are astray, we may not necessarily be people of knowledge, but we're acquainted with something from the sunnah. We're acquainted with the fact that this action of that individual, of that brother. It opposes the sunnah, so we teach them. We're acquainted, ikhwan, with the meanings of La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. And so when we come across that individual that seems sincere and wants to know and learn, we instruct them and we teach them that which Allah Azza wa Jal has blessed us to understand. And so that hidayah, that form of guidance, is guidance that is at the hands and in the hands of the people of sunnah. For indeed those who are astray, ikhwan, and those who are away from the path, what is it that they can convey if they themselves require guidance? As the scholars have mentioned, فَاقِدُ الشَّيْءِ لَا يُعْتِيهِ. The one who does not possess a thing cannot give it. And so it is imperative, ikhwan, that we study, that we learn, and fulfill and carry on and continue, as we mentioned, the legacy of the prophets and the messengers. For their legacy, ikhwan, was one of da'wah. Their legacy was one of calling to Allah Azza wa Jal. And that, ikhwan, does not occur and cannot continue to occur except at the hands of the people of sunnah. For indeed there are no more prophets and messengers. But Allah Azza wa Jal has continued to bless this ummah with people of knowledge and with callers to Allah Azza wa Jal. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make us from them. The one then who brings this irshad and brings this guidance to the people, it is not necessary that it is going to be accepted. Some people may take it and some people will possibly reject it. And thus this rejection and acceptance is not something that is in the hands of the caller. Acceptance and rejection is something that returns back to that individual and his choice. But know that when an individual accepts that and he sees it and he deems it something that is good and something that he should follow and something that he should believe in, and it enters his heart and he inclines towards it, then that is the second type of guidance, hidayatul irsh, hidayatul tawfiq. Hidayatul tawfiq, ikhwan, is the guidance of the heart. And that is not in the hands of any individual. Hidayatul tawfiq is that which is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah alone subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that guides the hearts of his servants. From them are those that he sees, yani, the inclined towards good, have chosen that good, and so he aids some of them. And from them are those who choose misguidance. And so as the great Imam Ibn Abi al-Izz al-Hanafi, he mentions in his explanation of al-Aqidah al-Tahawiyyah, that it may be that Allah Azza wa Jal, when an individual chooses misguidance, that Allah Azza wa Jal continues or aids him upon the path that he has chosen for himself. Just as Allah Azza wa Jal mentions concerning the Yahud, فَلَمَّا زَاغُوا أَزَاغَ اللَّهُ قُلُوبَهُمْ. When they chose to go astray and deviate, Allah Azza wa Jal made their hearts go astray. And so ultimately the affair returns back to their choice. When they made that choice, Allah Azza wa Jal left them upon the path that they chose for themselves. And indeed that was an evil choice. So hidayah then is of these two types. And so this dua of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he would make dua and supplicate, ikhwan. And when we make that supplication, of course we're asking for both of those affairs. Hidayatul irshad and hidayatul tawfiq. Hidayatul irshad, and that comes from the people of knowledge and those who teach us and inform us, and those who convey the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal and clarify it and make it plain. And hidayatul tawfiq is the tawfiq of the heart, and that is that we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make us accept his haqq and recognize haqq and truth for truth, and turn away, ikhwan, and have hatred for batil. Similarly, the Messenger of Allah in this dua, he mentioned, وَالتُّقَى, and I ask you for guidance and taqwa. And this taqwa, ikhwan, we oftentimes hear it, and we oftentimes come across it being mentioned in ahadith, in ayat, in narrations from the narrations of the Salaf, and from the great earlier pious predecessors. They make mention of the affair of taqwa. And our ulama da'iman and abadan, we hear them saying that I advise you first and foremost with the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And indeed, from the Salaf of this ummah, there were those who defined taqwa. Talq ibn Habib, he mentioned that taqwa, it is to act upon the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal, ala nurin min Allah, upon light from Allah, seeking the reward of Allah. And it is to stay away from that which Allah Azza wa Jalla has prohibited us from. Ala nurin min Allah, upon light from Allah. And the intent behind that light is knowledge, ilm. Fearing the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he said that indeed taqwa, it is al-khawf min al-jaleel. وَالْعَمَلُ بِالْتَنْزِيلِ وَالْقَنَاعَةُ بِالْقَلِيلِ وَالْإِسْتِعْدَادُ لِيَوْمِ الرَّحِيلِ. He said that indeed taqwa, it is al-khawfu min al-jaleel. It is to have fear of al-jaleel. Al-jaleel, a reference to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the mighty and majestic. وَالْعَمَلُ بِالْتَنْزِيلِ, and it is to act upon the tanzeel, to act upon the revelation, to act upon the book and the sunnah, to act upon that which Allah Azza wa Jal has given to us, and that we're not like the people of the book who came before. أَوَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِبَعْضِ الْكِتَابِ وَتَكْفُرُونَ بِبَعْضِ, believing in some of it and rejecting others, acting upon some, rejecting others. لا, we believe in all of the book. كُلٌّ مِنْ عِنْدِ رَبِّنَا, all of it is from our Lord. We believe in it and we act upon it to the best of our ability. وَالْعَمَلُ بِالْتَنْزِيلِ وَالْقَنَاعَةُ بِالْقَلِيلِ, and it is that we're satisfied with a little. Whatever it is that Allah Azza wa Jal gives to us, we recognize the dunya, ikhwan, is short. The dunya means nothing, ikhwan. If we're given plenty, alhamdulillah, and we try and use it in a manner that pleases Allah Azza wa Jal, and if we're given little, then alhamdulillah, ala kulli hal. Upon every circumstance, we praise Allah Azza wa Jal. If Allah gives us little, then we're happy. And we recognize, as the Prophet ﷺ mentioned, أُنظُرُوا إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ أَسْفَلَ مِنْكُمْ وَلَا تَنْظُرُوا إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ فَوْقَكُمْ فَهُوَ أَجْدَرُ أَنْ لَا تَزْدَرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ. That he commanded us, look to the one who is below you. يعني as it relates to the affairs of the dunya, not as it relates to the affairs of the deen. As it relates to the affairs of the deen, we look towards the one who is above us. But the Messenger ﷺ, he said, look to the one who is below you. يعني in the dunya, in the affairs of the dunya. وَلَا تَنْظُرُوا إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ وَلَا تَنْظُرُوا إِلَى مَنْ هُوَ فَوْقَكُمْ, and don't look to the one who is above you. For it is better that you give, or in order for you to give thanks and praise for that which Allah Azza wa Jalla has given you from blessing. And so he said, it is al-qana'atu bil-qaleel wal-isti'dadu liyawm al-raheel. And it is that we prepare liyawm al-raheel. We prepare for the day that we're going to travel. And ikhwan, that day could be closer to us than any one of us recognizes or realizes. The day that we're going to leave this dunya. And that is what we need to ask ourselves. How are we going to leave? How is it we're going to leave? And how are we in terms of being prepared for that day? For it verily, ikhwan, could be around the corner. If we're taken, and if it was said to us that you're going to die tomorrow morning, would you regret the life that you've lived? Would you regret not carrying out such and such and such and such? Would you regret the fact that we now have less than 12 hours to try and carry something out that will please Allah Azza wa Jal? How have I spent my life? How have I spent these years that I had before me? How will the scales fare? Because those whose scales are heavy yawm al-qiyamah, then indeed, they are the muflihoon, as Allah Azza wa Jal has mentioned. وَمَنْ خَفَّتْ مَوَازِينُهُ, and whomsoever scales are light, then they are those who have wrung themselves and lost out as it relates to themselves. And so ask yourself, yakhi, right now, if Allah Azza wa Jalla was to say, take my soul, right now, what is it that I have to give account for? How have I been in the dunya? How has my life been? Is there, in terms of ratio of good and evil, do my good deeds outweigh my evil deeds? Or are my evil deeds far greater? Or will we be from those whose good deeds and evil deeds are relatively equal, and so they are upon the A'raf, as Allah Azza wa Jal mentions in Surah Al-A'raf, وَعَلَى الْأَعْرَافِ رِجَالٌ, and upon the A'raf, or upon those plains, there will be rijal, And Allah Azza wa Jal, as it relates to A'raf, the scholars of Tafsir, they mention Ahlul A'raf, the people of the A'raf will be a people Yawm Al-Qiyamah, who will be upon a plane between the people of the hellfire and the people of Jannah. And they will be those individuals whose good deeds are equal to their evil deeds. And Allah Azza wa Jal would determine what will be done with them. And so, Ikhwan, the affair then of taqwa, it revolves around these issues. And Allah Azza, or the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam used to say, Al-Huda wa-Tuqa wa-Al-Afaf wa-Al-Ghina. Al-Afaf, that a person, it is oftentimes used to refer to the affairs of chastity. And it revolves around a person remaining chaste and exercising chastity and striving to be upon chastity. And that is something that we need to be reminded of here in England. Here in the UK, Ikhwan, where the affair of chastity is something, Ikhwan, that has now become like dust in the wind. Chastity. If you ask the general person what it means, they will struggle to give you an answer. And then if you attempt to look for it, you will struggle where we live to find it. But the Muslim, ayyuhal ikhwa, understands that those characteristics are noble. Those characteristics are characteristics that Allah Azza wa Jalla loves. And so he strives to remain upon them. The Muslims, male and female, they understand that in that is the good pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jalla. And so they maintain their adornment. They cover their aura. They maintain the affairs of segregation between men and women. They don't free mix in their gatherings. And they understand that in that is purity. And in that is the good pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal, regardless of how the people scorn it. Regardless of how they look down upon it. Regardless of how they consider us archaic, regardless. It doesn't matter to us. We understand that which Allah Azza wa Jal has blessed us with. From Huda. And we know that this is from Tuqa. And so we remain upon it, bihamdillah. And the final affair, Ikhwan, Al-Ghina. Al-Ghina is that a person strives to have no need for the people. He strives to be free of having any need for the human beings, and he connects himself to his Rabb and his Mawla. Anything that he asks for, he asks of Allah. When he seeks aid and help, he seeks that from Allah Azza wa Jal. And in every one of his actions and everything that he carries out, he tries to be free of having need for the people, and that his needs are, he returns them to Allah Azza wa Jal. And that, no doubt, Ikhwan, reminds us of a hadith of the Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came out to his companions and he said that verily Jibra'il had visited me just now. And he said to me, Ya Muhammad, Ish ma shi't fa innaka mayyit. Wa'mal ma shi't fa innaka mujziyun anha. وَاحْبِبْ مَنْ شِئْتْ فَإِنَّكَ مُفَارِقُهُ. He said that the Prophet, that Jibra'il came to me and he said, O Muhammad, live as you please, for verily you shall surely die. And do that which you please, for indeed you shall be recompensed for it. And love who you please, for you are certain to part from them. And then Jibra'il alayhi salatu wassalam, he said to him, wa'alam anna sharaf al-mu'min qiyamul layl wa'izzuhu istighna'uhu anin nas. He said, no, that the sharaf, the nobility of a mu'min, is with his qiyamul layl, is in him standing in front of Allah Azza wa Jal by night, that which we've just completed. وعزه and his honor is in استغناؤه عن الناس, is in him being free of having any need for the people. And so the companions, Ikhwan, when they would hear the likes of those ahadith, they wouldn't ask anybody for anything. If their whip were to drop from them for their riding beast, they would climb down, pick it up and remount their animal. Being free of having any need for the people and acting upon the likes of these ahadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, a dua, Ikhwan, that is jami', a dua that is comprehensive. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to make us from its people. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى وفقنا وإياكم لما يحبه ويرضاه وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد.